Good morning, everyone. In the previous session, we were discussing about various approaches for recovery and purification of the products from fermentation broth. We were also discussing about the solvent recovery for the reason that it has high value and also the problems which might arise from contamination of the product. In today's session, we will continue the discussion on recovery and purification of some of the specific products. And to begin with, we will discuss about the bioethanol recovery from fermentation broth. As a preamble, in the beginning of the 19th century, the key driver for industrial revolution was the fossil energy. This led to the technological and economical development of a country. Right. So the key driver or the key factor for the technological and economical development of a country was the fossil energy. If you just look at this graph, you can understand what is the demand of energy by the world. There was a remarkable increase in the global primary energy consumption, which is abbreviated as TPEC. The remarkable increase was each day. Day by day, there was a remarkable increase in the global primary energy consumption due to increase in population, number one, and number two, modernization. That is industrialization, basically the industrialization. So the industrial revolution was accompanied by a remarkable increase in the global primary energy consumption for the reason that increase in population and modernization. As a statistical data, if you analyze, in 2018, the world's TPEC, that is global primary energy consumption, it reached 160,000 terawatt hours. So the global energy consumption is given in terawatt hours, which is a unit for annual consumption of the major energy. And by 2050, it is expected to rise by another 57%. So now you can imagine to what extent there is demand for the energy. In just 30 years from now, the global primary energy consumption will be reaching, or it is expected to rise by 57%. Already now it is 160,000 terawatt hours. So by 57% rise means it will be approximately 245 or 50,000 terawatt hours. So it's a huge consumption of energy. So how is it possible to meet the demand? Definitely, we should look for alternative energy forms. The future access to fossil fuels may be severely limited. We all know that. We all are aware of the fact that fossil fuel availability for the future generations is limited, severely limited. The main concern is the change in the climate. So, there is a mandatory choice whether you require the energy, that is the fossil energy, or the environment. Because fossil fuels, there is increasing concerns over the consequences on climate change. So you are in a state now to make a mandatory choice whether you require the fossil energy or the environment. You have to choose any one. So we are in that state now. This is in turn that results in environmental crisis, major economic crisis, or sometimes even both. So definitely we will opt for environment. But we cannot stay without energy. So we need to look for alternative sources of energy. Is that clear? So fossil fuels will be substituted partially by new energy sources. Straight away you cannot shift. You cannot reverse the plate from fossil fuel to alternate source of energy. It is substituted. That is, fossil fuels will be substituted partially by new energy source that can fulfill the energy needs of humanity. Later on, we may end up in zero usage of the fossil fuels as we get acclimatized to the new energy sources. So fossil fuels will be substituted partially by new energy sources that can fulfill the energy needs of humanity. So what are the alternative sources then? The biofuels or the biological fuels. These are considered as a promising alternative energy source, which have the capacity or which have the potential to replace the fossil fuels. And the advantage is they can be produced from abundant natural renewable resources. So fossil fuel energy is from the non-renewable resources, but in biofuels, they can be produced from abundant natural renewable resources. Right? But there are limitations of the biofuel industry. Number one, limitation of feedstocks. And number two, higher production cost. The number two is very, very critical from industry point of view. But with these two important limitations, the advantage is they have produced a promising results. That means a promising results have been achieved with respect to environmental concerns. That means they are safe to the environment. Right. Though there are limitations of feedstocks and high production cost, promising results have been achieved from the environment point of view, that is, in the environmental aspect. Among the biofuels, the topic of today's discussion is the bioethanol. Bioethanol is considered one of the most promising substitute for the fossil fuels for the reason of several advantages. Number one, it can be effectively integrated into the current fuel system. See, this is very, very important because we are looking for partial substitution for the fossil fuels. So the bioethanol can be effectively integrated into the current fossil fuel systems, where 5 to 15%, that is bioethanol and gasoline mixture, does not require any modification of the currently available engines. Right? So 5 to 15% of the bioethanol or gasoline mixture does not require any kind of modifications of the or in the design of the current engines. That means it can be effectively integrated into the current biofuel system. The alcoholic fermentation of biomass feedstocks, that is example sugarcane, the starch crops. So these have been currently used as the main source for bioethanol production. So how to go about in the production line for bioethanol? What is the feedstock for bioethanol production? The sugarcane, starch crops, they serve as the biomass feedstocks for bioethanol fermentation. And the bioethanol market has reached 117 into 10 to the power of 9 liters in 2017. And now it is expected to reach to 119 into 10 to the power of 9 by 2020. So 119 into 10 to the power of 9 liters. So now you imagine how many zeros you have to add to that. It's a huge number. So much of demand is there for bioethanol. So bioethanol market is expected to rise to 119 into 10 to the power of 9 in this year by 2020. Even above this, there is a demand for bioethanol production. Right. The availability of efficient separation and purification technique is a big challenge in bioethanol production. For the reason that at least 40%, at least 40% of bioethanol production cost is spent on separation and purification technique. Right? So 40% of the bioethanol production cost goes for efficient separation and purification technique. So that is the reason why it is a major challenge. So 40% of your production cost, you are investing on separation and purification technique. So you imagine if you are not capable enough to get pure form of the fuel, then 40% of your investment is lost. And most important limitation is, in the bioethanol production, the ethanol itself becomes a limiting factor. So if you are aiming for an efficient production of ethanol, the ethanol by itself becomes a limiting factor. This is product inhibition. Because yeast cells, they are shown that they do not grow in ethanol concentration in the fermentation broth above 20%. Right? So that the ethanol producing capability of the yeast cells is totally blocked at 20% and over and above the 20%. So this is one of the important limiting factor for the efficient production of ethanol. So that is the reason why the availability of efficient separation and purification technique is very, very critical in obtaining the pure form of the ethanol. Right? So the fermentation and purification are the major steps during bioethanol production. Number one, fermentation. Number two, purification. Now the ethanol and the total water are the major components of the broth. Once the alcoholic fermentation is completed, the two major components are the ethanol and the total water. So the separation is needed to purify the bioethanol from the fermentation broth. So you are looking to take out the bioethanol from the fermentation broth, and we know that the major components are the ethanol and the total water. Right. So the easiest approach is distillation. So the distillation method or the technique has been used as the main purification technique or the method for recovery of the ethanol for several years. For the reason that it yields high alcohol, that is, alcohol recovery is 99%+. And sufficient energy efficiency at moderate feed concentrations. So you don't require larger feed stocks. Ability to simulate the process using process simulation softwares so that you can be thorough enough to understand if there are any issues in the recovery process or in the fermentation process of the ethanol using distillation technique. So these are some of the advantages of distillation technique, so that it is used as the main purification method for ethanol recovery for several years. But any technique, we know that it comes with a limitation or a negative aspect. And distillation is also having some of the negative aspects. Number one, azeotropes. It is not possible to dry effectively the product, here it is the ethanol, without coupling in or to additional separation methods. Because we know that the two major components in the fermentation broth in ethanol production is the ethanol and the total water. So the effective drying of the product is not possible without going for coupling using additional separation methods. And high energy consumption adds to the cost. And high operating temperatures. This leads to deactivation of microorganisms and proteins. Because it's a process of distillation. So high temperature is required. So as soon as the high temperature is used, if the unit runs on higher temperature, that leads to deactivation of the biological source, the microorganisms and the proteins. So these are some of the negative aspects of the process of distillation, though it has been used for several years as one of the best method for ethanol recovery. Keeping view of the negative aspects, different separation methods have been developed in the past few years. And these separation methods have been integrated with the fermentation process. Number one, pervaporation. Number two, gas stripping. Number three, adsorption. Number four, vacuum fermentation. And number five, solvent extraction. So we know that distillation has been used for several years as one of the best method for recovery of the ethanol, but due to some of the limitations associated with the distillation technique, Different separation methods have been developed in the past few years and they have been integrated with the fermentation process. And among them, the most important ones are number one, pervaporation, gas stripping, adsorption, vacuum fermentation, and solvent extraction. Now, what is pervaporation? Among the different membrane process, see, pervaporation uses membranes. So, among the different membrane processes, this pervaporation is the most promising membrane separation technology. It is widely used for azeotropic mixtures. We saw the limitation in distillation. That means azeotropic mixtures cannot be dried without coupling to another separation method. That is the important limitation of distillation. But now in pervaporation, it is taken care of. It is the most promising membrane separation technology and it is widely used for the separation of azeotropic mixtures, organic-organic mixtures, and for recovering dissolved organics from aqueous solutions. Right? So, compared to any other membrane processes used in bioreactors or the fermenters, the pervaporation is distinctive. It is having its special signature in terms of the use of non-porous membranes. Right? So, the use of non-porous membrane is dependent on number one, the membrane characterizations, and number two, the chemical properties of the mixtures intended to be purified or separated, such as the component diffusivity into the membrane and the hydrogen bonding ability. So the pervaporation membrane separation is distinctive in terms of the possibility of using a non-porous membrane. And the use of non-porous membrane relies on the membrane characterization and number two, the chemical properties of the mixture such as the diffusivity into the membrane and hydrogen bonding ability. So how this technique work? In pervaporation separation, the concentration gradient is created by vacuum. That means you apply a vacuum pressure so that a concentration is created by the vacuum pressure and this becomes the driving force for the separation. So it is the vacuum pressure which becomes the driving force for the separation in pervaporation technique. So as the upstream side of the membrane is kept at atmospheric pressure, vacuum pressure is applied on the downstream side. So what happens? There is a selective component which is dissolved in the upstream surface passes on to the downstream side through the membrane. Right? So a concentration gradient is created by vacuum pressure which is the key factor for the separation using pervaporation technique. And at the upstream side of the membrane, it is kept at atmospheric pressure, whereas the downstream side of the membrane, you apply the vacuum and the selective component which is dissolved in the upstream surface, now it passes on to the downstream side through the membrane. So if you just look at the illustration over here, typically the pervaporation system, it contains a feed tank, a feed pump, heater, a membrane module, a vacuum pump, and a cold trap. That is a condenser cold trap. So we have the fermenter and the fermentation broth, and there is a recycling pump so that the broth is recycled And then the most important component which is shown over here is the membrane module. And then the ethanol is pumped into the cold trap, the condenser cold trap, through a vacuum pump. So this is typically a setup of per-evaporation technique. Okay, now the membrane may be hydrophobic or the membrane may be hydrophilic. Now, what are the consequences of hydrophobic membrane and hydrophilic membrane? If the membrane is hydrophobic, then it will preferentially select organic compounds relative to the water, and other organic compounds will be recovered in the permeate. So there is a preferential selection of organic compounds over the water molecules. And then the organic compounds will be recovered in the permeate. What if the membrane is hydrophilic? Then the mixture liquid in the feed will be dehydrated and water will be recovered in the permeate. Right, so the membrane module can be hydrophobic or the hydrophilic. If the membrane is hydrophobic, there is a preferential selection for organic compounds over water, and the organic compounds will be recovered in the permeate. If the membrane is hydrophilic, then the mixture liquid in the feed will be dehydrated and water will be recovered in the permeate. So what is the limitation? Does this technique has any significant limitation? Number one, fouling is the biggest challenge leading to the loss of the productivity of ethanol. And the fouling may reduce the equipment performance so that it raises the maintenance cost by repetitive cleaning. It adds to the cleaning process and the cost increases. And it causes the contamination problems due to growth of bacterial cells on the membrane surface. The important limitation is the fouling. It is the biggest challenge leading to the loss of the productivity. That means it reduces the equipment performance and adds cost for repetitive cleaning of the equipment. And it causes the contamination problems due to overgrowth of the bacterial cells on the membrane surface. Though it is having advantage, the fouling is the biggest challenge or the biggest limiting factor of per-evaporation technique. So moving further, we have another separation technique for bioethanol recovery, that is gas stripping. Gas stripping is one among the separation techniques to remove the components by dissolving the mixture into gas passing through the fermentation broth. It is one of the separation technique to remove components by the dissolution of the mixture into a gas passing through the fermentation broth. So what is happening in this process? Gases such as carbon dioxide or nitrogen is recycled through the fermenter and evaporates the bioethanol. So the product, the bioethanol, will be recovered from the gas stream through a condenser cold trap. Right. So here in gas stripping, gases such as carbon dioxide or nitrogen, it is recycled through the fermenter, and then the bioethanol evaporates, which will be recovered from the gas stream through a condenser cold trap. Right? as it does not require any complex equipment. It is only passing of the gas, carbon dioxide or nitrogen, through the fermenter. It does not require any complex equipment and does not need any modifications for the fermentation unit. So gas stripping, even today, it is considered to be a simple recovery and purification process. Right? So as you can see in the schematic, we have a nitrogen gas used for the gas stripping. And then the ethanol nitrogen into the cold trap 1 and you have cold trap 2 so that the ethanol is recovered via the condenser cold trap from the gas stream. So it is considered to be one of the simple process because it does not require any complex equipment and also does not require any modifications. So, I'll stop my discussion over here. We can continue our discussion in the next session. Thank you for your kind attention. Thank you very much.